In many conferences I've been invited to, I often reiterated that there are two reasons why man is the dominant animal on this planet. The first is his ability to adapt, which is as a result of enormous intellectual talents he possesses. The second is his ability to communicate in a complex form, a feature that other animal species do not have. In A Brief History of Mankind, Yuval Noah Harari has written, "To what did the success of the sapiens owe? How could we settle so quickly in so many distant and ecologically diverse habitats? How could we relegate all other human species to oblivion? Why?" The debate on this subject continues to be very heated. The most probable answer is precisely that which makes the debate possible. Homo sapiens conquered the world, thanks above all to his unique language. The Israeli historian and essayist is correct in claiming that human being possesses a unique capacity among the living beings that populate the heart. They communicate and express themselves through articulated sounds which are organized in words. Their language is complex and is composed, according to need, of parlances, idioms, phrases, facial expressions, lexicon, and specific terminologies. Depending on what they intend to communicate, they use different dialects, jargon, slang, writing, style, attitudes, and various other techniques. Depending on how he wants to communicate, they can be as orators, bringing out their capacity for gab, loquacity, and eloquence. Language, to be clear, is the most important system of human communication. It is the main form of symbolic mediation that is realized through the construction of articulated figures and is useful in conveying the meaning of one thought. Language, as Cole explained, is a tool with which we build and legitimize the reality that surrounds us, and above all, it's the first source of socialization. Language and communication are two sides of the same coin. But what is the communication? As a professional writer and publisher, my answer, based on qualified text and experience accumulated over many years of work in the sector, and is the following. Communication literally means to share, but specifically it's the art of transferring one's knowledge to others. What is made common in communication are not material goods, but messages that express intention, feeling, information, and ideas. The communicator always has a purpose to share the information in his possession with other people. The communication process is based on five elements: the sender, the medium or tools, message, language, and recipient. Knowing how to communicate, the ability to transfer knowledge from oneself to an audience, means that all above elements must be satisfied in the best possible way. Therefore, depending on the message to be conveyed and the recipient to whom the message is to be delivered, the sender must choose the best medium, the best tool, and the most appropriate language. In the commerce, for example, the simple process is the norm. Literal adherence to the principle according to the individual skills and techniques adopted will decrease success or failure, the success or the failure of the product. As far as the diffusion of political ideas is concerned, it all gets much more complicated, and the sender's message, especially when the language is not politically correct, may not reach the recipient for the interference by power that distorts the free communication. In modern societies, technological innovation enriched language over time, and the mass media became protagonists. While they expanded the possibility of communication, they also made previously unknown propaganda tools available to the authorities. Today, the mass media have become a source of power, an instrument of influence, and an innovative means of societal control. The arena, too, the second, the arena where many of the events of national, international public life take place. Third, an important source of definition and images of social reality, and therefore the place where cultural changes and both individual and group values are built, preserved, manifested, and distorted. Four, the necessary path to achieve fame. Five, the source of a system of meaning used by public sphere, which aims to provide and impose criteria for defining what is normal and not. Given this consideration, it's not difficult to understand why the mass media have always aroused so much interest since their inception. The definition of fourth power is not accidental. It's not surprising, therefore, that everything concerning the distribution and exercise of power revolves around communication and, more precisely, around the message conveyed by the mass media in the form of information, opinion, news, and entertainment. Do you remember Juvenales, Panem, et Circenses, no? For any political regime, from tyrannies and dictatorship to the much-vaunted more democracies, the boundary between communication and propaganda is so blurred that we consider the former a synonym for the latter. From the Soviet Andrei Alexandrovich Zhdanov to the Nazi Joseph Paul Goebbels, up to the various contemporary public departments for information and publishing, the priority is one and only one, instead of informing, to indoctrinate. Orwell thought as well. In Principle of Propaganda by Leonard Dube, the author summarizes the German National Socialist hierarchy founding principle of propaganda. Are 11. The first is principle of simplification and unique enemy. It is necessary to adopt a single idea and a single symbol. Second, the principle of contagion method. Bring together several opponents in one category or in one individual. Third, principle of transportation. Blame the opponent for your mistake and defects, responding to attack with attack. Four, principle of exaggeration and misrepresentation. Turn away anecdote, however small, into a serious threat. Five, principle of vulgarization. All propaganda must be popular, adapting its level to the least intelligent of the individuals to whom it is directed. The larger the mass to be convinced, the smaller the mental effort to be made. Six, principle of orchestration. Limit propaganda to a small number of ideas and repeat them tirelessly, always presenting them from different perspectives, but always converging on the same concept. Seven, principle of continuous renewal. New information and arguments must be constantly issued as such a rate that when the opponent responds that public is already interested in other things. Eight, principle of plausibility. Build fictitious arguments from different sources through so-called ballon d'essai or through fragmentary information. Nine, principle of silencing. Pass over in silence the question on which there are no arguments, or conceal news that favor the adversary. 10, principle of transfusion. As a general rule, propaganda always operates from a previous substratum, whether it's a national mythology or a complex of traditional hatreds and prejudice. 11, principle of unanimity, making people believe that the opinion expressed are shared by all, creating a false impression of unanimity. It's creepy, isn't it? From Grillo in Italy, for example, from Grillo to Salvini, or from Trump to Sanders in USA, from the neighborhood politician to the noble statesman, Goebbels, willingly or not, is the mentor, is the teacher. Today, as in the past, they continue to use, for example, blonde girls with braids to spread fake news useful for the power that be at Usum Delfini. Never forget Alvin's words from Woody Allen's 1977 movie Annie Hall, referring to Lyndon Johnson. He says, "He's a politician. You know the ethics those guys have. It's like a notch underneath a child molester." Commercial propaganda, however tendentious, is a legitimate means of marketing. Political propaganda, on the other hand, is the worst that communication can offer. While the former does not stand as an oracle of truth, the latter is so presumptuous as to think it is. There is no doubt that liberal and libertarian ideas have always found themselves between the anvil of regime and propaganda, the hammer of democratic equality, that in Italy is mockingly called the par condicio. How should anyone who cares about freedom behave? What are the desirable solutions to reduce the interference of government in communication? To answer these questions, be aware that in the world, in some countries more than others, everything that gravitates around culture and communication in general smells terribly of socialism and collectivism. There is only one reason for this. The state stubbornly looms over every area that has to do with the dissemination of ideas and knowledge. It dwells in the sector of education of every order. It occupies information. It has been trying to meet the World Wide Web. It doesn't live alone among sports and recreational activities. I believe there is one and only one solution: the exit of the state from every cultural sphere. It is urgent to liberalize everything. It's necessary to abolish every professional guild, every law and or regulation that is relevant to knowledge. It is essential to eliminate public contribution and subsidies to the world of communication. Any legislative interference in negotiation between employers and employees. It is necessary to make a clean slate and let ideas find their place in the free market. As far as communication and freedom are concerned, internet was the only positive note at the end of the last millennium. Do you remember the word of the John Perry Barlow's Declaration of Independence, cyberspace? He said, "We are creating a world that all may enter without privilege or prejudice accorded by race, economic power, military force, or station of birth. We are creating a world where anyone, anywhere, may express his or her beliefs, no matter how singular, without fear of being cursed into silence or conformity." In these few lines, there is perhaps the answer to the three questions mentioned earlier. The state, the power, the government, use the definition that you prefer, hate those who do not conform, abhor the ideas of freedom, and strive to prohibit them from circulating freely. The arrest of Julian Assange last April is a proof of this. Those who do not align with the single thought, with the public opinion, rightly lauded by Mises, are dangerous. That's why the web must return to being that wonderful libertarian society that has made us dream and has given us prayers of ideological freedom, where to have access to the most disparate knowledge, where to choose what to read and compare in real time facts and opinion. It is no coincidence that internet is the only sector politics has not yet managed to exit, would like, despite widely known attempts at censorship. Only by defending the oasis of freedom that cyberspace has made available to us will we be able to defend good ideas and point to the enemies of freedom for what they are. The problem is that people only realize how important freedom is when they have lost it. And very often, we don't even realize that we have lost it, the freedom. Only a few days have passed since the anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Do you believe liberals have done enough to show the world what atrocity socialism is? Before the fall, socialism represented the worst side of the human being, a concentrated of hatred, envy, pride, and resentment, the consequences of which, every time that ideology took power, have been millions of the other individuals who have suffered hunger, misery, and death. Freedom won. In 1989, we shouted to the world that freedom won. Today, that symbol of incivility has disappeared from the maps, but socialism still lives and thrives among us. Now it is called 21st century socialism and continues representing only hatred, envy, pride, and resentment. I'm half Venezuelan. You know what I mean. It is paradoxical, but yesterday's enemy is the same of today. Only name, actors, not everybody, and methods have changed, but the Goebbels style of the communication remain. Marxism has become neo-Marxism, but its criminal ideas remain the same. They remain intact and circulate, thanks to democracy, without indignation. No, sorry, 2 minutes. No, I don't want question. I'm horrified when I read that the millennials, as reported the CNN articles last year, are becoming the largest generational group in American history leaning to democratic socialism. A 2016 Gallup survey found that from 55 to 70% of 18, 29 years old said that they had a positive view of the socialism of Bernie Sanders, and the last presidential campaign was instrumental in appreciating this ideology. The demolition of the Berlin Wall, as I said in my last book, has not crushed communists and communists. On the contrary, paradoxically, its collapse has taken away from the West reason to point the criminal ideology in the most appropriate way. Now is a dictatorship, democratic dictatorship. Let's go back now to the book of the Yuval Harari, which explained that it was the cognitive revolution of the sapiens to mark the end of the Neanderthal and it therefore stands at the point where history declares its independence from biology. Until the cognitive revolution, the action of human species belonged to the realm of biology, or, if you prefer, prehistory. From the cognitive revolution onwards, historical narrative replaced biological theories as our primary means of explaining the development of Homo sapiens. To understand the birth of Christianity or French Revolution, it is not enough to understand the intersection between genes, hormones, and organisms. It's also necessary to take into account the interaction between ideas, images, and fantasies. Paraphrasing the Israeli professor, communication is everything. Is everything. Is all. Those who don't communicate disappear. Just as Homo of Neanderthal disappear. Thank you.
Thank you. We have time for 2 questions.
I agree.
I just have a comment, and that is that you're fighting a war that's already been won. Even China is capitalist, even though it calls itself communist.
China is a great problem because now in China there is a fight of civilization from a country that stay in the first place in the freedom, how is the name?
Index.
Okay, in the freedom index and the communist. It's terrible. I think that in the next 10 years, this one is the one important fight of the century.
My question is, what do you think of Antonio Gramsci and his idea of getting inside communication? And could we libertarians adopt a similar strategy as Gramsci suggested?
In the book that I wrote in Italian, The Wall and His Rubble, I think, Calcinacci, I explain how is important Gramsci. The commies win because adopt the Gramsci theory. Libertarian, I think that is important that use the same strategy, because the problem of libertarian is the communication. I love, for example, Javier Milei, a fantastic economist in Argentina, Austrian economist, that in front of the politics, he said all the question about the situation, the real situation. And he explained that the politic is not the solution, but the problem. Libertarian adopt this strategy and in the future win. Thank you.